So gender expression, what does gender expression mean? Gender expression refers to all of the external characteristics and behaviors that are socially defined as either masculine or feminine. Okay, so it would be the baking, the crocheting. Such as dress, grooming, mannerisms, speech patterns, and social interactions.
An example I can provide for you is cross-dressing. Cross-dressing refers to people who wear clothing and or makeup and accessories that are not traditionally associated with their biological sex. Okay? Now, go ahead.
So, I have to say, so we've got to be very careful with certain terms. Cross-dressing being one of them that traditionally has been something folks have used. I would caution every single person in this room from using it. It has a lot of negative connotations. I'm not saying annotatively you'll find it in the dictionary, but be very careful because the idea is that somehow I'm crossing over from something that is normal, right? Which is what Pilar said. We've got to be very, very careful. So cross-dressing. Things like transsexual, those kind of terms are a bit archaic and kind of in this space.
I have a list of terms that we're going to sort of touch on a little bit in one of my future slides, but that's a really great point. So so gender expression. So this is talking about basically, gender expression, gender stereotypes. Next slide. So gender identity, how is this different from gender expression? Gender identity is really distinct from sexual orientation and refers to a person's innate, deeply felt psychological identification. How you feel as a man, a woman, or some other gender, which may not necessarily correspond to the sex assigned at birth. A term that we're going to explore is transgender, or trans. And this is an umbrella term for people whose gender identity or expression is different from those typically associated with the sex assigned to them at birth. Next slide.
So this symbol here is the
transgender symbol. And what it really represents here, it's a combination of the male and female sign, and then it has a third arm that's representing transgender group. Okay, so the next slide. I'm going to talk a little bit about the transition process. And this, I'm going to touch a little bit on this, but this will sort of become more important later when we talk about workplace policies and practices and really best practices. So understanding the transition.
Be active aggressively. Filing complaints in federal court to stop unlawful conduct and obtain money judgments. Often requesting temporary restraining orders, asset freezes, and other power.
We need a little bit of a technical Okay, so understanding the transition process. Transgender individuals, some of them may find it necessary to transition from living and working as one gender to another. These individuals may seek some sort of medical treatment, such as counseling, hormone therapy, electrolysis, and reassignment surgery. Some individuals, however, will choose not to pursue any form of medical treatment. Medical treatment, such as sex reassignment surgery, can often be very costly, and many times it's not covered by health insurance. So it's an important point to remember is that each transition process for an individual can be very different. And some individuals choose not to have sex reassignment surgery. So let's move to slide 11. A couple important points to remember in terms of the transition process, okay? One, especially in the workplace, talking obviously about sexual identity and transition as it relates to the federal workforce. But a couple things to keep in mind is confidentiality, right? An employee's transition should be treated with as much
much sensitivity and confidentiality as another employee's significant life experience, such as a hospitalization. Medical information received about an individual employee is protected under the Privacy and Rehab Act. Next slide. I'm sorry, keep it on the other slide, sorry. Dress and appearance. Tammy touched on this a lot, so I'll just sort of reiterate. Employees who begin their full-time transition will be dressing at all times at the close of the gender they now identify with. Agency dress codes should be applied to employees transitioning to a different gender in the same way that they're applied to other employees of that gender, just as Tammy said. Names and pronouns. So, names and pronouns, this is also an important one. Managers and supervisors and coworkers should use the name and the pronoun appropriate to the employee's new gender. Managers, supervisors, and coworkers should take care to use the correct name and pronouns in employees' records and communications regarding the employee. Next slide.
Question?
Yeah.
So what if
My name is Eleanor Sims. My question is, in formal settings, either in person or through correspondence, if you don't know the gender that the person identifies with, what's the most respectful way to ask what salutation they prefer, whether to refer them as him or her? This comes up a lot, and we do our best, but what's the best way that folks have found to do that?
I think that's a great question. Ashley, would you feel most comfortable answering that?
Eleanor, first of all, thank you for at least thinking and understanding that you should ask. I get this literally every day, maybe more than an hour. I wish I got a dollar. but the very best thing you could do and should do is to ask. And I can promise you that anyone who is someone who could be considered gender nonconforming will appreciate that you understand to ask rather than leaning on your own assumptions that today she has a tie and therefore she wants to be called he. Where I can promise you, I've never identified as male. And I can also assure you, especially with transgender individuals, especially if they're in transition, whether that transition is over or not, should determine how what pronouns we use. Does that answer your question?
For specificity, for example, should I say, what salutation would you like us to use? How would that question change in person? Without being disrespectful or being nosy, but, in terms of day-to-day business.
For emails as well. Don't
right. So, for example, I want to send you an email, I want to send you a formal agency letter, I want to make sure I get it right, but I don't want to be disrespectful in asking about your personal business.
So, I think the point here, and anybody in the audience that has a different perspective, let me know. I think the point is that we assume that it is somewhat or somehow disrespectful to ask. That by asking, we're being disrespectful and saying, just to be clear before we move forward, for she or he, Mr. or Miss, right? I think when we get over that understanding that somehow it's disrespectful to ask, we'll be more comfortable in saying, this agency practices a full, equality and respect, and quite frankly, we've gone through training, and because of that, we are required to ask these kind of things. And that puts it on your agency, not on you, not that you're doing anything that's up. Thanks.
Let's talk quickly about terms to use, knowing what to say and what not to say. This sort of goes along with your question a little bit, right? So non-offensive language, transgender woman, transgender man, gender transition, gender identity, LGBT, those are all non-offensive terms that are appropriate. 13. These are some of the ones that are obviously offensive and could potentially be offensive, right? As Ashley pointed out, cross-dressers potentially offensive.
There's a couple other ones out there, you can read them for yourselves, that are obviously offensive. I'm going to skip over a little bit of the law because I think Tammy touched on that. So let's actually go to Layla. We're going to do a little bit of improvisation here. Let's go to slide 22, please. So EEOC's actions post Macy, there's a couple of things that have happened just this year that are pretty interesting that the EEOC has done as recently as September of 2014. The EEOC filed two lawsuits against two different companies accused of discrimination against transgender employees. This is the first time that the federal government has brought a suit against the Civil Rights Act, under the Civil Rights Act of 1964 to protect transgender workers. So those were just filed in September of 2014. Let's now move to slide 23. Also, in 2014, there have been some significant victories. Let's talk about some major milestones that have happened since Macy in just the past couple months. February 2014, Facebook added more than 50 custom gender options for users who do not identify as simply male or female. In March 2014, the Fairness for All Marylanders Act, a bill that would prohibit discrimination on the basis of gender identity in employment, housing, public accommodations, and credit, was passed by the Maryland legislature and was signed into law by Governor O'Malley. Maryland became the 18th state, along with the District of Columbia, to protect residents and visitors against discrimination on the basis of gender identity and expression. In June 2014, OPM announced it was removing exclusion of transition-related health services for federal employee benefit plans. To note, though, since November 10th of 2014, there are only three federal employee health benefits providers that will be offering transition-related health care coverages in 2015 for transgender federal employees. Only three. Aetna, Kaiser Permanente, and the Foreign Service Benefit Plan. Kaiser's plan will significantly lag the scope of coverage. So it's a small victory, but it's still important. And then obviously in July 2014, President Obama signed an executive order banning workplace discrimination against millions of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender employees and federal contractors in the federal government. And then finally in April 2014, the U.S. Department of Education issued guidance clarifying that Title IX prohibits discrimination against transgender students. So those are a couple of huge victories that have happened just in the past couple of months that are important to note. And I think that I'm just about out of time, according to Laura.
Just as you transition over, we can pay attention to your facts.
Resources, and I got a lot of this stuff from the Human Rights Campaign website. There's a fantastic map that shows a lot of the state laws, and I actually have it here. I really wanted to show you guys. Here's my. This is. So this is from the Human Rights Campaign website, and this shows this shows the states that prohibit discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. And this is pretty up to date. This shows, I think Maryland there is included, right? Yes, yeah. Just as I discussed, Maryland is included in there. So that is available on their website, so definitely check that out. And well, again, I think all of these slides will be available for the folks who don't have the printouts and who are interested in seeing more of this presentation. I wasn't able to cover a lot of this stuff.
Thank you. I know, Layla, you need to set up. Do you have a phone up here?
Yeah.
So as we transition over, I think it's important to kind of blend these two incredibly important presentations by noting three things, right? So we talked about gender identity, gender expression, as well as sexual orientation. Whether you know it or not, every single one of us in here has all three of those, right? And it does not matter if you are LGBT or not, you have a sexual orientation. It doesn't matter whether you are gender conforming or non-conforming, you have a gender expression as well. And you also have a gender identity that may or may not match the sex you got at birth. So keep those things in mind, because a lot of times when you use the term sexual orientation, everybody thinks you're automatically talking about someone being gay or lesbian or bisexual, which is not the case. And I usually tell folks all the time, if you can't think of what any of these terms look like, draw a little stick figure of me, probably figure it out really quickly, because I think along the lines of gender expression, identity, and things like that line, I usually raise that like exclamation point in a lot of people's minds, which is good. We got uncomfortable and we got comfortable together. Which is probably why I love people a lot. So with that though, we're gonna slide over to social media, because I can probably bet 99% of us in here has some type of social media footprint. And I'm really excited to see this blending of the topic of employment discrimination and social media. With that, we'll pass it over to Ms. Kiesel.
Thank you, Ashley. Let me know if this is a little bit too loud. Hey, Beverly. we're going to switch over here to the social media effect on employment discrimination. Does everybody have one of the handouts from out back? If not, there are plenty here. And I would just ask, just as a favor, if you could hold your questions till the end. But if you have something burning, that's fine. I'll take the question. So what is social media? I think most of us have an idea of what it is. Most of us probably have accounts. Facebook, LinkedIn, Pinterest, Google, MySpace, Twitter, YouTube, Flickr, Instagram. And if you don't, you probably have either children or relatives that actually do have them. And they probably post things about you. I wanted to give you a couple of stats here. On social media use, there are over 901 million Facebook users in the world. Every 2 seconds, somebody is linked in. Over 50% of North American population has a Facebook account. 21% of users say they have removed a photo, status, or comment for fear of repercussions from their employer. 82% of users pay attention to their privacy settings, and 6% don't. 60% of workers check their personal social media account more than once a day on their mobile devices. And although I haven't included it in this presentation, I have two things that I kind of coined: social media post-traumatic stress disorder and social media phobia. For those folks who have either been, you know, violated or traumatized online in some way, for example, I had my identity stolen, and the only way I knew it was they posted on my Facebook site something very profane. And one of my friends said, "Hey, way to go, Jen." And I said, I didn't post that. And I knew immediately that my identity had been taken. And social media phobia is just, hey, we know it's out there. We know we may have two or three accounts of our own with different aliases. Or you know, you just don't really want to pay attention, kind of put your head in the sand over social media. It's out there, it's coming. The majority of this presentation is based in the private sector, and it is gonna come. It's coming to the government. I think Tammy mentioned there are a couple of cases actually actively on her desk with regard to social media. So, you know, this title is coming sometime, put your head in the sand. So, hopefully being a little knowledge here. I'm gonna go with the introduce bad employees, people who actually post things about themselves or their coworkers online and have actually been fired. So in 2013, a Taco Bell employee sent a photo of a coworker licking a stack of taco shells. I really hope that none of you are having fast food today, because the next two slides are disturbing. The shells were provided for training, they were going to go to the trash. But Taco Bell immediately suspended and eventually fired the employee for violating food handling procedures. Next slide. Everybody like Wendy's? Yeah? So this guy is drinking. I wish the camera were on this side so that they could see the expression on their faces. Wendy's fires an employee for posting a photo of him eating from a frosting machine. They investigated, they fired him.